Hi and welcome. In this lecture, we're gonna see two things, two topics. The first one is we're gonna discuss scattering and thermal loops, finally. So we started to introduce interactions in our quantum field theory last lecture. Now, whenever we have interactions, we can talk about scattering, decay of particles, and computing scattering in the case of observables is precisely what will allow us to compare theory and experiments. So it's one of the crucial points of the whole particle physics business, being able to make predictions. And in order to make predictions, we need to understand how to compute such observables. As we discuss this topic, we're going to see that we will need an additional ingredient to discuss, to actually construct the observables, which are called propagators. So the last part of the lecture will be devoted to the discussion of the propagators. As usual, I'm not going to enter into too many details. I'm just going to give you some practical recipe to compute the things. And then, of course, if you're interested, you can either have a look in the notes of the course, or even better, to a proper book of quantum theory. So let's start with scattering and fermion loops. So what do we measure experimentally? Well, what do we measure experimentally is simple number of paths. Okay, suppose we create a scattering experiment like the LHC in Geneva. So we take proton, another proton, we collide them, and in this collision, the interactions will produce outgoing, or if you want, daughter particles. Okay, and what the instrumentation, what the experiments measure is the properties of these outgoing particles. So they measure the number, they measure their energy, their distribution in angle. So all these observables related to what happens in the final state of a reaction. Okay. So in order to compute this number of particles, or the properties of the particles in the final state, we usually compute two quantities. The first one is called cross-section. And we compute cross sections when we have scattering between particles. Okay, so we will always consider scattering between two particles. So we're going to consider two particles in the initial state with momenta p1 and p2, producing in general n particles in the final state, whose momentum I'm going to denote by q. So here is going to be q1 plus Q2, until we get to Qn. Okay, so this is a scattering process, and the corresponding quantity that we will compute is the cross section. Okay, we will see later on how to connect the cross section with the actual number of particles that we measure. The other quantity, which is of extreme importance, is the so-called decay width of an unstable particle. So in this case, the initial state consists of just one particle, so whose momentum is going to be denoted by p1, and then the final state can be again an n particle state, and let me label again the momenta as q1 to qn. Okay. The decay width is the natural units is the inverse of the mean length. Okay, so the cross-section will be denoted by sigma, or even better, the differential cross-section will be something like d sigma in the omega, or d sigma in some energy of the final state, and all these kind of quantities. Okay, so the total cross-sections will be just denoted by sigma, but we can also measure the so-called differential cross-sections, in which are the, for instance, this one is going to be the cross-section for unit of solid angle. This one is going to be the cross-section for unit of energy in the final state, and so on and so forth, depending on what the experiment measures and what we are interested in. Okay. The same thing is valid for the decay width. Since we have just one particle in the initial state, it is usually convenient to go into the rest plane of that particle. So the frame in which the particle is at rest, so the only energy available is the mass energy. And what we compute is the decay width, which is usually denoted by capital gamma, which is connected to the proper lifetime of the particle by 1 over gamma in natural units. Okay, remember that in natural units, 1/time as units of energy, gamma will have units of energy, okay, as we're going to see. So this is dimensionally consistent. Now, how do we compute this fixed? Well, again, I'm just going to show you the formula, which is what we will need in this course. So let me write. So the differential cross section, d sigma, is going to be equal to one flux factor, which takes this expression. So it's 1/4. Then I'm going to take the square root of the scalar products between the two initial momentum minus the products, the product of their masses square. Okay, so this is the initial flux. Then we're going to have a factor which is 1/S that I'm going to define in a moment. Then let me put here another factor which is modulus of A squared. This is the quantity that our theory will give us, and it's called the squared of the matrix element. So A is going to be the matrix element. And then we need to take into account the n particles in the final state. And this is done using the so-called n particle phase space, which I'm going to denote for the moment with this symbol, and I'm going to give an explicit expression in margin. Okay, so this is the formula for the differential cross section. Okay, so it's differential cross section because you see that here there is some differential that I'm going to specify in 30 seconds. What about the decay width? Well, for the decay width, the formula is a bit simpler. So the initial flux is drastically simplified because in this case we don't have two particles to worry about. We just have one particle. So going into the rest frame of this particle, so this is in the rest frame of the mother particle, okay? The flux is simply given by 1/2 the mass of the initial particle, okay, of the particle which is decaying. And then the rest is exactly this. It's 1/S, the square of the matrix element times the phase space of n particles. Okay, so given this formula, once I'm going to define what 1/S and this phase space is and how to compute the matrix element, we can compute the cross section and the decay width given a certain thing. Okay, so let me specify what this 1/S and this d phi n. So 1/S is called symmetry factor, okay? And it's there to take into account that whenever you have identical particles in the final state, you are overcounting their phase space, okay? So the idea is that we will compute the phase space always in the same way, independently on the fact that we have identical particles or no in the initial, in the final state. But if identical particles are present, then we are going to correct the result by the symmetry factor. Okay, so suppose small n of the particles in the final state, okay, so of particles in the final state are identical, then this 1/S is equal to 1/n. Okay, this 1/n takes into account the fact that we are overcounting phase space. So what is the expression for the phase space? Well, the expression for the phase space is not very simple. So let me write it up here because it takes some space. Then I'm going to show you a specific example, which is the one that we will use in most of the cases that we will discuss in this course. Okay. So the phase space in general, d by n, with n particle in the final state, is given by this expression. So there is a product over all particles in the final state of this differential here, which is a different, the Lorentz invariance, the invariant differential with which we are familiar with at this point of the force. Then there is another factor of 2 pi to the fourth, and then there is a delta form, which is giving the conservation of momentum. Okay, so this is, for instance, P1 plus P2 minus Q1 minus Q2 all the way to minus Qn for the scattering. Or it's equal to P1 minus Q1 minus Q2 all the way to minus Qn for the decay. Okay, so you need to adapt the delta here to the case in which you're considering, because the total, the initial momentum can be different. Okay, if you want, this can be written in a much simpler way in the following way. So let me write this expression. This is simply given by the total initial momentum minus the total final momentum. Okay. Now let's see an example of this object, because written like this, you see that it's a pretty complicated object. Okay. So let's specify to for our example, we will specify to two particles in the final state. So we either have a scattering 2-2 or a decay 1-2, and we use the center of mass frame. Okay, so the frame, which is defined as the one in which the three momentum, the total three momentum, vanishes. Okay, so this is total three momentum is identically equal to zero. So you see that in the case of the decay, this center of mass coincides with the rest frame of the decaying particle. In the case of a scattering, that is the usual idea of center of mass that you have since the basic courses on physics. Okay, so there is really nothing. So in this frame with two final particles, the phase space is given by the following form. So we have here the element of solid angle between the momenta, the three momenta of the two final particles, divided by a factor which is 32 pi square. And then here we have a big square root. And inside the square root, there are the following factors. So it's 1 minus the difference between the masses of the final state square, divided by small s. This is the Mandelstam variable. I'm going to define it in a moment. Okay. And then the other factor is very similar, but is not written in terms of the difference, but rather of the mass of the final particle states. So this is m1 plus m2 squared divided by s. Okay. So this is the expression for the two body phase space in the center of mass. This small s, which is the Mandelstam variable, is defined in such a way that it is proportional to the total energy of the process. Okay, so in the case of a scattering, so if you want, this s is simply given by the initial four momentum square, which by momentum conservation is also equal to the total final four momentum square. Okay. So in the case of the decay, you see that the initial four momentum is the four momentum of the decaying particle. And you remember from special relativity that whenever you take the square of the momentum of one particle, you take the mass of the particle. So in the case of decay, and only in the case of decay, this S is equal to the mass square of the particle, which is exactly the total energy of the particle. While in the case of a scattering, it will simply be given by the sum of the energy. Okay, we're gonna see a specific example later on, so I'm gonna make this discussion a bit more precise. Very good. So now let me comment on two more important quantities that it's good that you have in mind, because they are connected with the number of with experiments, with experimental results, and what experimental collaborations give us as the results of their analysis. So the two concepts that I want to discuss now are the following. First of all, the idea of luminosity. So luminosity. So the luminosity of an experiment is a number given by the experiment, which is representing the total amount of data that the experiment has collected. Okay. From the practical point of view, once you know the luminosity of your experiment and you know the cross-section of the process that you're interested in, then you can compute the total number of particles produced using the following formula. So the total number of particles produced is equal to the cross-section times the luminosity A. Okay, so you see that the cross-section, being a cross-section, has units of length square. Okay, so the luminosity will have units of inverse length square. So this has units of area, and this has units of inverse area. Okay, the units which are usually employed talking about cross-section or luminosity are Barn, pico-Barn, femto-Barn, or inverse Barn. Okay, so the Barn, which is denoted by B, is 10 to the minus 24 centimeters square. Okay, so you see that usually we're gonna talk about very small cross-sections. Very good. So this is the first. Concept that I wanted to discuss. The second one is the idea of branching ratio or branching fraction. They're synonyms, so we will use the two interchangeably. So what is the branching ratio? So the idea is the following. Suppose you have an unstable particle. Okay, let me call this unstable particle A, capital A. And suppose that this unstable particle can decay into many final states. Okay, so there is not only one final state available, but it can decay into many final states. So an example that is going to be of fundamental importance for us is going to be the Z boson. So you remember the Z boson that is one of the mediators of the weak force. So the Z boson turns out to be unstable, and experimentally, it has been measured that this guy can decay, for instance, into a pair positron electron, mu plus minus, tau plus tau minus. It can decay into QQ bar pairs, and so on and so forth. Okay, so you see that there are many available decay channels for the unstable part. So let's suppose this is the case. Okay, so let's suppose that we have many possible J representing many possible final states. So for each one of these processes, we can define a decay width, which I'm going to call gamma sub J. Okay, so this is the decay width for the A particle to decay into the final state labeled by J. Okay, so of course, once we know how to compute gamma sub J, then we can also compute the so-called total decay width, which is given by the sum over the decay widths of all possible final states. Okay, so the total decay width, which I'm going to denote by gamma sub tot, is equal to the sum over all possible j's of gamma j. Okay, so once we know gamma j and once we know gamma tot, the total decay width, we can construct the branching ratio, which I'm going to denote by BR, in the channel J as the ratio between the decay width in that channel divided by the total decay width. So what is the meaning of this ratio? Well, you see, if there were just one decay channel, then this gamma tot would be equal to gamma J, and this branching ratio would be equal to 1. And this is telling us that there is probability one, so 100% of probability, of that particle to decay in the final state. Since this is generically not the case, but there are many final states available, this ratio quantifies the probability for the decay A to J to happen. Okay, so these are two quantities that are very important, and it's good that, that you keep in mind. Very good. So now that we have discussed how to compute cross-sections and how to compute decay widths and their connection with experiments, of course, there would be much more that we can say, but this is the minimal amount of information that we're going to need. We still have one problem to solve, which is how to compute the matrix element of the process, right? So the matrix element is an input coming from the theory. So for each theory that you consider, you will in general have different matrix elements, and this will result in different cross-sections or decay widths, and comparing with data, in principle, you are able to disentangle and distinguish and exclude a certain type of theories. Okay, so let's see how we can compute that matrix element. And to do the computation, we need to introduce some concepts from scattering theory, okay, which again is a huge subject. So I'm just going to present you the essential points. So suppose we start with some initial state, and due to interactions, we end up with some final state F, completely generic. Okay, we are not specifying what the initial state I and the final state F are at this point. So what is the amplitude for this to happen? Well, the amplitude that I'm going to call capital M, if you remember from your quantum mechanics course, can be written in the following way. So this is the matrix element of an operator, which is called S matrix, between the initial and the final state. Okay, so this is the so-called S matrix. And scattering theory also gives us a formula for the S matrix. Okay, the S matrix, S, is equal to the t-ordered product that I'm going to define in a moment of the exponential of minus I, the integral over space-time of the interaction or interacting Lagrange. Okay, so this is not a closed exponential. What this formula is telling you is the following thing. You need to expand this exponential in powers of the interacting Lagrange, and what you obtain is 1 minus I integral in d for x h of x plus 1 over 2, the integral in d for x, d for y, t product of h interaction x, h interaction y, plus higher order terms. Okay, so this this prescription, this this formula is just a compact way to denote this infinite series. Okay. Since the interactions usually are very complicated, it is impossible to resum the series and write a closed form for this expansion. Okay, that's why in quantum field theory we usually do perturbation. When you see in the papers or in the books that quantum field theory can be solved in the perturbative limit, it means precisely this. We are not able to compute the closed form for the S matrix, but we can just expand this formula and stop to a certain order in the interactions. Okay, so that's why we do perturbation theory. This series is called Dyson series. Now, what is the meaning of this T product? Well, the T product is a product that is telling you to put the operators in temporal order. Okay, so for instance, for two operators, T OX TOY, the T product is defined in the following way. So we put the theta function that selects the X times larger than the Y times. And then here we put the OX, OY factor. But then there is also the other possibility. There is also the possibility that the Y time, the zeroth component of Y, is larger than the zeroth component of X. So we also take into account that possibility, adding the other possibility. Okay, so here is OY, OX. So you see that what this time product is telling you is to write the operators, which in general won't commute, okay? Remember that not necessarily they will commute. We know that in quantum field theory, they must commute when they are one outside the light cone of the other. But if they are inside, they do not necessarily commute. So what this T product is telling you is to write the product in such a way that the leftmost operator is the one that comes later. Okay, so that's the meaning. Very good. So we know what T is, we know the expression for the Dyson series. So a convenient way of writing this Dyson series is the following. So you see that one is the part of this S matrix that doesn't do anything. It would be different from zero, it would give a matrix element different from zero only when the final state is initial to the initial state, is equal to the initial state, which is not interesting, okay? We collide particle, we look at the decays because we want to measure what comes out. And if what comes out is equal to the initial state, then we don't gain any information, okay? So to put the role of the interactions on a special foot, we're gonna write this S matrix in the following. One plus I, an operator, which is called the transition operator, and I'm gonna denote I, capital T. Okay, the matrix element A that I wrote in the formula for the cross section and the decay width is simply defined as the matrix element between the initial and the final state of this T operator. Okay, so this is the object that we want to compute. Now, to compute this object, of course, we need to know how to treat all these terms in the Dyson series, okay? Because this is simple, of course. Here we already start to have the problem of the time product. And whenever you have the time product of many, many operators, then things start to be really, really complicated, okay? Fortunately, there is a theorem, which is called Wick theorem, that simplifies our life. So let me show you the content of Wick theorem. So Wick theorem is a theorem that allows us to compute arbitrary the time product of arbitrary products of operators. And what Wick theorem is telling us is the following. So take the product of n operators and take the time ordering of these operators. Okay. So this object is equal to the following that I'm going to define. So it is the normal ordering, which is defined by this symbol of the two points, of the simple product of these fields, plus all possible contractions of the fields. So now we need to define what the normal ordering is and what the contraction of fields are. Okay. So the normal ordering is simple. So whenever you have the product of fields like this, what you need to do is to write all creation operators on the left. Okay, so what you formally do, you split this into positive and negative energy parts, you start to rearrange the products in such a way that the positive energy part, the negative energy parts, which A, creation operator, are on the left. Okay, so you rearrange by hand. That's the meaning of this normal operator. It's not that you write a product and then you apply the normal order. No, the normal ordering is the way, the prescription that you need to use to write this product. What about the contraction? Well, the contraction between two fields is defined in the following. So we have a symbol for it, which is this symbol here. And this is the matrix element between vacuum of the time ordering of the two fields. Okay. And this object is something that we will also call DF, x1 minus x2, and it's the so-called Feynman propagator. Okay, so this is an object that we will have to learn how to compute. So this is the propagator. So once you know this, and once you know this, then you see that you can compute the T product of any of the product of any number of operators. Okay, so let's give an example just to see what happens in a concrete case. So example, suppose I want to compute the T product of phi1, phi2, phi3. So this is equal to what? So this is equal to the normal ordering of the three operators, three. And then I need to take all possible contractions. But since contractions are taken involving two fields at a time, you see that I can take phi1, phi1 with phi2, phi1 with phi3, phi2 with phi3, and I'm done, because these are all possible contractions. So here I need to add phi1, phi2 with phi3 normal ordering, plus phi1, phi3 with phi2 normal ordering, plus phi2, phi3 with phi1 normal. Okay, so this is the content of weak theorem in a very simple case. And then of course you can generalize. You can generalize to fermions. So there is nothing special about bosons. Okay, you just need to take to be careful about the possible minus signs, because remember the fermions anti-commute, while bosons commute. But in principle, you just sit down, you do the computation, and you see what happens. Okay. So now we have all the ingredients to compute that matrix element of the T operator. Okay, yeah, the matrix element that enters into the formula for the cross-section or the decay method. Of course, as you can see, all this procedure is quite cumbersome. I mean, there are many things that you can do. There is nothing preventing you from doing it, and it's actually good a couple of times to do it, to do the computation in full glory, to understand what are the important points. But there is a simpler way, which works 99% of the times, which was discovered by Feynman. So Feynman discovered, or if you want, invented, a set of rules, which goes under the name of Feynman rules, that are able to encode in some simple way all the content of the Dyson series and weak theorem when combined for the computation of the matrix element. So let me tell you how the Feynman rules work. So suppose you have some interaction happening. Okay, so this is something which is described by an interaction Lagrangian, an interaction Hamiltonian. And suppose you have some initial states. So here on this side, I have initial states and some other final states. Okay. So suppose we take some initial state which is entering, or some So this, with this, I mean that there is a particle that enters with momentum p in the direction that goes into the interaction. With this arrow, which is you see as the opposite sense, as the opposite direction, I mean that this is an anti-particle. Okay, so I will use whenever the momentum is in the, in the direction of the arrow, then I'm talking about the particle. When the momentum is in the direction which is opposite of the arrow on the line, then I'm talking about an antiparticle. Okay? And the same thing here. So suppose I have something like this. Here I have ongoing momentum P and outgoing momentum. Okay. So I'm saying that the initial states, they all have incoming momentum, and the final states all have outgoing momentum. Okay. So the final rules are the following. So here, for an outgoing particle, you put a factor which is UP. Okay. So remember that U is the wave function associated with the positive energy part of the field. Here you put a V bar P. Okay, so with bar, I either mean dagger for scalars and vectors, or the bar in the Dirac sense for fluids. Okay, so bar is equal to either dagger when I'm talking about spin zero and spin one, or it's dagger gamma zero for spin one half. Okay, so on the final state, we always have the bar wave functions. Well, here we have the unbarred one. So this is U of P and this is V of P. Okay, and the rule is that to write down your interaction, what you need to do is the following thing. So it's I said something wrong. This is like this. So the bar goes here and not here. Okay. So whenever you write down the interactions, you just follow backwards the line particle antiparticle. Okay, we're going to see an example in one moment. But always remember that you start from the outgoing arrows and you go back to the ingoing arrows. Okay. Now, what happens inside here? Well, what you have inside here are interactions and propagators. So we're going to see how to compute propagators in 5 minutes. So let me just give you a prescription for computing the interaction. So suppose you have an interaction that involves N fields, okay? So something that, an interaction that involves N fields. So the Feynman rule for that interaction can be computed simply taking I times the derivative of the interaction Lagrangian taken N times, and this derivative is taken with respect to the fields that are appearing in the interaction. Okay, so I'm generically writing here phi as the fields, but these phis can be different fields. Okay, so it's good to give an example of this object. So remember that yesterday we saw that the interaction between a massless photon and a Dirac fermion are of the following way. It's G, the photon, and then this photon couples to the conserved current, therefore a Dirac fermion takes this, this expression here. So what is the Feynman rule which is associated with this interaction? Well, the Feynman rule is the following. So let's write the interaction. So you see that I have a photon with index mu, then I have an outgoing fermion, psi, an ingoing fermion, psi, and this Feynman rule is given by I times the derivative of this interaction with respect to the fields involved. So this derivative must be taken with respect to AU, psi bar, and psi, and what's left is this factor of G and the gamma mu matrix, which is here. Okay, so this is the Feynman rule for the interaction between a massless photon and a Dirac field, and the Dirac speed. Okay, and of course, when you write the amplitude, the matrix element with the precision that I gave you to start from the outgoing arrows and going back to the ingoing arrows, then you automatically get Lorentz invariance of the amplitude. Okay, so that's why that rule works as a pattern. So if you write, if you do things following the prescription, then you get a matrix element which is automatic, which is exactly what you want. Okay. So Now that we have all these ingredients, we're missing how to compute propagators, okay? And now we're gonna compute, give a prescription for the computation of the propagators. Later on in the course, in a few lectures, I will suggest some exercises to get yourself acquainted with this formalism, and I'm also going to solve one complete computation for you, okay, so that you see how these things work. So, propagators. So, propagators are completely independent from interactions, and they're actually connected with the idea that particles can propagate between two interaction points, so between two different points in space-time. Okay, so we need the idea of a particle which is moving in space-time. So since the idea of propagator is connected with particles moving, the only thing that matters is the free Lagrangian that contains the kinetic terms. Okay, so let's start with the free Lagrangian. And let me write the free Lagrangian in the following form. Okay, so using integration by parts, it is always possible to write the free Lagrangian in the following way. For complex fields, in this way. Where this O is some operator that depends on derivative and the mass of the field. Or for real fields, I just put a factor of 1/2 in front. Okay. Now, once you have written the Lagrangian, the free Lagrangian in this form, then what you have to do is to go to momentum space. And this you do simply taking the derivative and substituting it with minus I, the four momentum of the particle. And once you have done this, the propagator is equal to I times the operator which is appearing here, written in terms of minus I, the momentum, the mass, inverse, okay? So you identify this operator, you write it not in terms of derivatives, but in terms of the momentum, and then you invert it, you multiply it by I, and what you obtain is the propagator, okay? So let me give you some examples. So let's start with the scalar. So in the case of the scalar, the propagator is, which is usually denoted in the following way, with a straight line. So for scalars, we use dashed lines. So this is the propagator of a scalar with momentum p, and its expression is I over p squared minus m squared. There would be, in fact, another term here, which is plus I epsilon, which is the so-called final prescription, but I won't bother writing it right now, okay? We will write it when we need it. So, but just keep in mind that there is a small piece here that I'm ignoring in this lecture. Now, what about spin-1/2? So for spin-1/2, so for fermions, we usually use continuous lines. So the momentum is taken like this, and this is equal to I divided by p slash minus m, okay? And if you use the properties of the gamma matrices, you can immediately convince yourselves that this is I p slash plus the mass of the particle divided by p squared minus m squared, okay? So it's very similar to the one of a scalar field, but now in the numerator we have a spinor structure, okay? And now let's go to the case of a massive spin-1 particle. The case of the massless spin-1 particle, I will discuss in 10 minutes. So the symbol that we use is this wavy line. And the result is the following. It's minus I divided by P squared minus M squared. And here we have a tensorial structure. So let's say that the index at the beginning of the propagation is mu, and at the end of the propagation is mu. So here we have the metric tensor, G mu mu, minus P nu divided by the mass square. So this is the propagator of a massive spin one particle. And you immediately see that if we try to take the mass X limit, so we try to send M to zero, this has no problem, but this term is blowing up. So this is already telling us that the fact that you remember, in taking the massless limit for a spin one particle, we're actually losing 1 degree of freedom. This is manifesting itself also at the level of propagator. Okay, so let me show you how to get this result from the Lagrangian, and then you can do the exercise for the other form, which are much simpler. So I will consider the case of a massive spin one particle, complex since the real case is very simple and it's completely analogous. So the Lagrangian, if you remember, is given by the following form. It's minus 1 over 2, because it's complex, V mu nu dagger V mu nu plus M squared V mu dagger V mu. Okay. Now what do you do? So now we follow the prescription. You remember that these involve derivatives. Okay, so we can integrate this object by parts. And integrating by part and going into momentum space, this thing is equal to the following expression. So I have V mu dagger minus P squared minus M squared plus P mu, sorry, G mu mu plus P mu, all contracted with V. Okay. So I strongly urge you to do this this small exercise of seeing how from here we get to this point. And if you don't, if you're not able to do it, we can discuss during the discussion session. Okay. So now this is the operator. So this is the operator O, which in this case has two tensor indices that needs to be inverted, okay? So now we need to devise a way to invert this, this operator. So in order to invert this operator, what we're gonna do is the following. So let's define two projectors, two momentum dependent projectors. So the first one is Pt mu mu, which is simply given by G mu mu minus P mu, P nu divided by P squared. Okay, so this is the projector in the transverse direction to the motion. Okay, so this is something that if you apply to P, you see that it gives zero. And then there is the projector along the longitudinal direction, so along the direction of the motion, which is simply given by P nu divided by P squared. Okay, so the idea now is the following. We write the O operator in with the composite into a term which is proportional to Pt and a term which is proportional to Pl. And once we have done that, so once we write O mu as some coefficient A Pt mu nu plus a second coefficient B Pl, P longitudinal mu nu, then once we are able to do this, it is immediate to compute the inverse because this is simply given by 1 over A Pt mu nu plus 1 over B Pn mu nu. So if you multiply this by this, okay, with the right contraction of the Lorentz indices, you see immediately that you get the identity. And so this is precisely the definition of the inverse. So let's do it. Let's take this. This operator and let's decompose it on the transverse and longitudinal project. So you see that this is easy, right? Because this term is automatically proportional to the longitudinal one. So this second term, so let me write here, oh, mu nu, the second term will be p square p left mu nu, right? So p mu p nu, it's p square, because I take this denominator, I put it up, and I get this. Now, what about the first one? Well, the first one gives a bit more trouble, but you see that it's not, it's not really much trouble, right? Because g mu nu is here. So what I can do is to write g mu nu as p transverse plus this object, which is p longitudinal. So g mu nu is p transverse plus p longitudinal, both mu nu. Okay. So this is the decomposition. So you see from here that we can reorganize. So let me write independently the terms that depend on the transverse and on the longitudinal projector. So this is minus p square minus m square, p transverse. And then the longitudinal one is given by the sum between this term and this term. So you see that the factor of p square cancels out. And I'm simply left with minus plus m square p longitudinal, which is precisely of this form. So now we can immediately invert. Okay, so let's invert. So the inversion of minus one mu nu is given by taking the coefficients of the two projectors and taking one over the coefficient. So this is simply given minus one over p square minus m square, the transverse projector, plus one over m square, the longitudinal projector. Okay, and now what do you do? Well, now you remember the definition of the transverse and longitudinal projector. You open up, you organize in terms of g mu nu and p mu nu, and you obtain exactly the expression that was written here. Okay, so let me skip that passage because it's not, we're not learning, it's just algebra. Okay, we're not really learning. What is important for us is how to invert this kind of tensors that depend on momentum. Okay, so it is always possible to decompose them in these transverse and longitudinal projectors, which are defined precisely in terms of momentum. Okay. Very good. So this is what happens in the massless case. Now, what about the massless case? Well, you see immediately that the massless case go wrong because of the following reason. Let's go here, which is the decomposition of the tensor, okay, the mu nu tensor, the old mu nu tensor, into the transverse and longitudinal projectors. So you see that when I take m going to zero, the longitudinal projector disappears completely, and only the transverse one is left, and what we obtain is minus p square, the transverse projector. Okay. So that's why there is the problem that one term, this term, blows up in the propagator, because we are losing one of the two projectors. Okay, and since we are losing one of the two projectors, we cannot simply invert this operator as we did here. Okay, so what can we do? So does this mean that we can't compute propagators for massless Q1 particles? Well, no. I mean, this is a bit too radical. Okay, so there are way out. So there are various ways that we can tackle this problem. So let me just list a couple, okay, which are the important ones for us. So let me cancel this one because it serves its purpose. So let's remind ourselves what is special about the massless case. Well, if you remember, we saw in the last lecture that whenever we have a massless Q1 particle, for our theory to be Lorentz invariant, then we need to ask that the coupling between this particle and the current is given by a conserved current. Okay. If you remember, massless particles can only couple to conserved currents. So once we realize that the massless particles can only couple to conserved currents, we can ask ourselves the following question. So suppose we are considering a process like, so there is a certain current here, another current here, okay, so for instance, two fermions and another two fermions, and I am exchanging some massless photon in between, okay? So this is precisely what happens in a Coulomb interaction. So how, what happens when I write down this amplitude? Well, you see that this thing will be the amplitude on one side, the other current, sorry, the current on one side, the other current on the other side, and in between what I have to connect them is this propagator, okay? And the propagator, as we saw, is something like this. It's minus I divided by p squared minus m squared. Okay, so let me start from the massive case, and then we see what happens. G mu nu minus p nu divided by m squared, and here I have the J. But now we remember that if we want and if we insist to take the massless limit, there is one information that we need to put into this computation, which is the fact that this current and this current are conserved. Okay, so when we take the massless limit, we can take simply the limit blindly, which is this n goes to zero, but we need to take into account the fact that in that limit, this photon is coupling with a conserved J nu and a conserved J nu. Okay, conserved meaning that therefore divergence is equal to zero. So what happens in momentum space? Well, this is precisely the statement that P mu J nu is equal to zero. And so you see that when we insist that a consistent quantum theory that couples massless vectors to currents should couple to conserved currents is giving us the following result. Whenever I contract this P nu with this J nu, I obtain zero, and the same thing here. So at the end of the day, the amplitude, the matrix element for this process is going to be simply given by J mu squared, that is a factor of minus I, P squared minus M squared. And for this, I can, without any problem, take the massless limit, and I obtain this result. Okay, so you see that one trick, one way out of the problem of the propagator blowing up is to simply remember that the currents to which the massless particle is coupling to are conserved. So we start with a massive propagator, we use current conservation, and then we take the massless. Okay, so this is a possibility. Another possibility is to add by hand a longitudinal term in the Lagrange. So this, that term will provide us the longitudinal part of the tensor. And in that case, we can invert it without any problem. Okay. Of course, that term will be completely arbitrary. So you can already imagine that at the end of the day, any physical prediction can't depend on the coefficient that I put in front of the term, because it's my choice, the coefficient that I put in front of. Okay, so this is actually a good way of cross-checking your results. You can put a generic coefficient in front of the object, I'm gonna write it right now, and you can keep it and just do the computation, and at the end you should write, you should obtain a result which is completely dependent on the coefficient. So let's do it, let's see what happens. So the term that we add to the Lagrange is arbitrary, we said. So there are various choices. One possible choice is to add the following term. So let me write directly for a photon. Okay, so I'm going to use the F mu nu notation. And the term that I add is called the gauge fixing term. And let me add it, for instance, like this. It's d mu a mu squared. So this is Lorentz invariant. If you open it up, you discover that it has a longitudinal piece, which is precisely what you want. And it depends on this arbitrary parameter, which is called the gauge fixing parameter. Okay. Now, for more complicated theories, it will in general be more convenient not to follow the massless limit starting from the massive case, but to add a suitable gauge fixing term, because this will allow us to simplify the expressions appearing in our Lagrange. Okay, but we will get there at the same point. So when you do the computation of the propagator adding this gauge fixing term, you discover the following thing. So the propagator form that is given by this Lagrange. So here is P, has the following expression. It's minus I divided by P squared. And then the tensor structure is given by G mu nu. Oh, sorry, let me take another pen. So it's given by G mu nu minus a term which depends on this gauge fixing parameter times the longitudinal project. Okay, so this is an exercise that I leave for you. So show that if I add this gauge fixing term to my Lagrange, okay, so it's something that I do by hand, I obtain this gauge propagator. And you see immediately that the same kind of reasoning that we were applying in the case of the massive propagator that goes to the massless limit only after we use the information that the current is conserved, apply here, right? So the term which depends on the arbitrary parameter is the longitudinal one, but the longitudinal one won't ever give any contribution in amplitudes like this, simply because it will give zero whenever we contract it with the current. Okay, so at the end of the day, you already see from this argument that psi should not, cannot appear in the final expression. Of course, there are more complicated diagrams that you can write. Okay, but still, always remember that the final result, which is physical, can't depend on our choices. So at the end of the day, this psi should cancel completely from the computation. Okay, so very good. So I finish here for this lecture. Next lecture, we're going to see a few examples. So we're going to do an explicit computation of a cross section. Okay, so we're going to take what will be quantum electrodynamics, and we're going to compute the cross section for electron-electron going to electron-electron. We're going to see all the problems that arise and what we need to do to solve them. And then we're almost ready to really talk about QED. Okay, so see you next lecture, and thanks for the attention.